Good evening and welcome to the council meeting of the town of Newmarket on Monday, June the 23rd, 2014. All members of council are present and Mayor Van Bynen is presiding.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Members of council, you do have your agenda before you, and as well, we have some additions to the agenda. I wonder if I could have someone add these items to our standing agenda. Second. Councilor Emanuel, Councilor Sponga. All those in favor? Now let's remember, we need to push the button. Having determined the agenda then, are there any declarations of pecuniary interest? Councillor Hempen.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I will be declaring a conflict in item number 17 and number 19 in regards to the official plan, the secondary plan. I want to be clear that I own a property at 232 Penn Avenue and an adjacent property that falls under the discussion of the secondary plan.
Thank you. Regional Councillor.
Thank you. I'm going to be declaring a conflict on item 31 in the Committee of the Whole, June 16th, and that's the, I forget the proper term, but the Heritage Registry. And one of the properties on the list is a property I own.
Thank you. Okay. Now, before we start our presentations and recognitions, I would like to advise our community that this evening is the last evening that our Commissioner Prentice will be participating with this council. And on behalf of council and myself personally, I wanted to acknowledge your contribution over the many, many years. I believe it was 26 years, Mr. Prentice, and acknowledge just exactly how you've made Newmarket even better. And I don't know whether that was a test of your gestalt or not, but the very first mentor that I had on council was Rob. He's done an awful, in addition to working well as a mentor, not only with the senior management team, but also with council and myself personally. I want to thank you for that. You've been involved in a lot of transformations in the way council does business. And I'm thinking around the Let's Make It Happen and the transformation of the way we do business and how that changed the organization to be more customer focused. And in fact, it becomes the basis in which we are now extending our service into our different kiosks, et cetera. So you've made a very substantial contribution, Rob. I appreciate it. And I know that Newmarket is a much better municipality because of what you've contributed to us. Can I invite some comments, Mr. Prentice?
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I always like making surprise speeches. It has truly been a privilege to work with the councils and the staff in the town of Newmarket, and it has been a privilege to be able to be a part of so many things that the town has done over the many years and the many things that have happened to make Newmarket a better place to live. It's truly rewarding to work in a job where you can have an effect on your own community and to raise your family in that community, and I wouldn't have traded it for anything. And I really appreciate the support that you and the council and our CAO and my colleagues have given. Thank you very much.
Next item is our presentations and recognitions. Presentation and recognitions, and I would like to call on Gad Perlmutter to come forward and talk about what we're celebrating here this day.
Are you okay?
That's good. And if you press the button on the center, then we'll be able to hear you on the broadcast.
Awesome. Okay. All right. Good evening. So I'm here to introduce a very special group of girls on a basketball team. So this is the YMBA Avengers U15 girls team. Who won Division I gold at OBAs in London this past May 2014. The division had 60 teams participating across Ontario with 8 different divisions. It has been an unbelievable season, going 29-0, Our team has ranked in the top five every year for the past 5 years. We have a disciplined, well-balanced team where every player contributes to winning the game. The reason we have success is that these girls are focused on their end result and want to improve as a team. They are a very close group of girls who share in each other's victories as their own. Our season has not ended. We are headed to the tournament in Ohio, AAU Nationals in Boston, and Nike Nationals in Washington this summer.
So, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
We'd like to recognize their achievements and have members of council join us in the center circle and make some presentations. Regional Councilor, did you wish to make some comments before we went there?
Just want to quickly say, as somebody who grew up playing basketball, that I think what the York North Basketball Association is doing in town and in the area is fantastic. And yeah, the way you're supporting these young teams, and I know that I helped out Jason a little bit with the under 13 boys tournament that was just recently, and to see this team, what they're doing, excelling, and then being able to travel these locations and represent Newmarket so well is absolutely incredible. And it's an added bonus for me to be in a room with this many people the same height as me. It doesn't happen that often. So. Anyway, congratulations, girls.
Thank
incredible.
You.
Thank you. Let's join the team.
No, I gotta call you one
of the. Yep. He'll call them up one at a time so that we can present certificates. Yeah, that's what'll happen. Good.
Yeah. All right.
Good.
Emily Hardman.
Congratulations. The certificate for you. We'll stay here and we'll take a picture with council. Nikki. Congratulations, Claire. Good job. That's for you. Sarah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Oh. Joey. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Madison.
Hi.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Haley Bromer.
Yeah. It's okay. We're here. It's okay. We'll organize it. Congratulations.
Thank you.
There you go.
Charlie Clayton.
We're missing.
Thank you.
We'll trade them. Yeah, there you go. Is that? And is this?
Yeah. Oh, that's the other coach.
Okay, so maybe what we could. We're in the hands of our communications group here now. You want to stand on the chair. Yeah, let's move in. Good. Are you good? Okay. No chair. Yep. This is good.
Okay.
There we go.
Counselor 20, can we just get you to squeeze right in there?
Okay. Perfect. Okay.
You guys run plays, but it's a photo.
One, two, three, and.
All right. Congratulations. Members of council will bring each of their own chairs back. There we go. That's good.
I can take it if you want.
There you go. Good luck.
I thought you were going to stay for the meeting.
We've seen the meetings before. Yeah.
I thought you were all here for the development charges.
Next item is deputations, and with council's indulgence, I'd like to bring forward item number 22, which is a deputation from Mr. Scott Chalua. Scott, if you'd like to come forward, please. And this is item number 22 on our agenda, so will we permit up to 5 minutes, Scott, for deputations?
Well, I apologize, I'm wearing two hats tonight. But good evening, Mayor Van Bynen and councillors. My name is Scott Chalua, and I'm here on behalf of the councillors of Copper Hill Subdivision in Ward 1. We've been lucky enough to be working with alongside Councillor Tom Bay on a recent community initiative, and we're here today to hand over the 300-plus signatures that we've gathered in support of this initiative. So Newmarket, as you know, is a town of about 85,000 residents and only one splash pad for kids to play in and cool down during the hot summer months. This single splash pad is located in the northern half of the town, and it's not easily accessible for most Newmarket families. Our neighborhood of Copper Hills is home to 600-plus families and within 5 minutes of another 3,000 families. Frank Stronach Park, at the center of the splash pad, at the center of the Copper Hills, is an ideal location for a second Newmarket splash pad due to its easy access, minimal traffic impact on our community, and space available for such a facility. Over the last 3 weeks, myself, along with 7 other families in the neighborhood, we've met, canvassed the neighborhood, and amassed over 300 signatures in support of a splash pad in the neighborhood. We understand that with any new amenity in town, there'll be construction, increased traffic, and potential parking challenges, but we feel that we have the ideal location within town's limits to build such a structure and are okay with these minor inconveniences that we might encounter. Many of the members of council were present at the park's dedication ceremony in November 2013, so you know what a great facility it is, and imagine how much better we can actually make it. So we want this splash pad in the neighborhood not only because we have the space and the support of neighbors behind it, but because of the positive impact it can and will have in our children's lives. Unstructured physical activity and play, much of what you see at parks, splash pads, or other open spaces, has enormous health benefits. The benefits of physical activity, especially these forms of unstructured play, far outweigh any of the costs associated that are either perceived or real. So a splash pad in a community such as the Frank Stronach Park is a low-cost, low-maintenance, accessible, and enjoyable way for children to get physically active and be involved. So on behalf of the families involved in organizing this petition, the over 300 families who support the splash pad, and the health and well-being of our children, our most valuable asset, we implore you, the members of Newmarket Council, to support the development of a splash pad at Frank Stronach Park in the Copper Hill subdivision for all of Newmarket children and families to enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions of clarification, Councillor Vey?
Scott, thank you very much for your deputation, and thank you also to you and your neighbors for all the hard work going door to door to over 600 doors. And the word really did get through the community, as I've given to you. There's about I received about 50 emails from residents in the community in support of the splash pad. And this is something that's a brand new community, and it seems to have really brought people together on that. So congratulations to you and to your neighbors. I would like to move that we receive the deputation and refer this request for a splash pad in the Copper Hills to the 2015 budget process. And I'd also like to have it referred to our recreational master plan to have staff take a look at this and start investigating this also.
Okay, thank you. And that is seconded by a regional councillor. Any further comments? Councillor Vick, regional councillor, is the seconder.
Yeah, I'll just briefly add that, you know, congratulations on the incredible effort you and your neighbors have put forward to bring this to our attention. And I do think that the town needs to look seriously at a full-service splash pad in Newmarket through the next term of council, and I think this is, you know, along with other sites should be given a lot of consideration as we go through that process and we refer it through to the budget. So thank you for the work you did.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Oh, that's right. Sorry, we're waiting for our technology to catch up with us. Okay, so the motion then is to receive and to refer to the capital budget process as well as the recreational master plan. All those in favor?
I may need help. Yeah, you know what? I'm going to use. Thank you. No, I was looking. I need some help with my computer here to vote. But I just wanted to take this opportunity to thank staff. And today we had a soft opening of our first splash pad in Newmarket, a community splash pad, and that's taken place in Ward 4, in the ward that I represent. And council supported it, and I want to thank council members for supporting. And it's such a great addition to Ward 4 in our community. And for those people who don't know where Rogers Park is, it's behind Canadian Martyrs School, and it has four access points, actually. Yorkshire, Cherrywood, Harrison, and London Road. So it's a great addition. I want to thank staff and my colleagues for supporting it. So thank you, Mayor. It was a good opportunity now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I voted great. In favor.
Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate you coming forward. And we'll give this consideration as part of the overall process. And the clerk is receiving the 300 names.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next deputation is Adelina Urbanski. She's the Commissioner of Community and Health Services at York Region, and she'd like to speak to us about regarding the endorsement of the Human Services Planning Board at York Region on the Make Rental Happen and the Fair Access projects. Adelina? Now, normally, we have you under deputations. Normally, we would have you under presentations. Would 10 minutes cover it?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Good. That's good. So we'll treat this as a presentation.
Thank you very much, Mayor Van Bynen and councillors. It's a pleasure to be here, partly because there's broad issues at play, but also partly because the town of Newmarket has been a partner in a number of the things that I'll speak about tonight. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Adelina Urbanski. I'm Commissioner of Community and Health Services from the Region of York, and I'll be speaking about the Human Services Planning Board and two of the areas in particular that the board is focused on these days. We are a conglomeration of about 24 different service agencies and sectors, including hospitals, education, the local municipalities, and so on. You can see who everybody is there on the chart. And I think everybody's also well aware that Councillor John Taylor is the co-chair of the Human Services Planning Board, and he has assistance by Susan LaRosa, the former director of education for the Catholic Board as well. So generally speaking, the board has been concerned primarily with issues around collaborative advocacy and capacity building, and focused on a couple of key results areas that relate to low and moderate income families, and looking at economic self-sufficiency, so helping those families out, but also the very thorny issue of affordable housing. At the end of the presentation, we'll just ask that you continue to support the initiatives, which I doubt will be a problem for this council, knowing the history and the issues that have come before you in the past, and continue to, we're looking at continuing to get support from other local municipalities as well. So looking at the issues that they've been involved in, and particularly if we look at the housing issue in particular around all of York Region, these are some of the quotes that we've had from various personalities, but also people living in the region. And it's not a secret, and I think everybody knows that the cost of housing is becoming really quite an eye-opener. It has been for a little while. It's getting a little more difficult. Well, it's getting more difficult to find suitable, affordable, safe housing. There are lots of things that the town of Newmarket has done that is way ahead of the game. So in some respects, there have been some mitigation strategies already put forward and endorsed by town council here. But across the board, we know that families are having a harder and harder time finding affordable, safe, and adequate housing. And the data kind of continues to speak to this and supports it. So if we look at the mix of housing, it's not just the cost of it, but the mix and the availability of what is actually out there. If you go and you try to do a search and look at the housing stock, you can see that in the GTA, York Region has about 11.5% of its total housing stock is actually rental. The rest is home ownership, which is very, very high, and you could argue is a wonderful thing that home ownership is so within reach for so many families and provides a certain quality of life. But the flip side of that is that for people's ages and stages, for where they are in their lives, that can be very difficult to find an affordable and an appropriate apartment, as an example. So you can see how we compare to the province of Ontario, Canada-wide, and if we were to compare ourselves with our neighbours in Toronto, Toronto has almost half of their housing stock actually is rental apartments. So there's a lot of movement in the system, and there's a lot of choice there. We know that on average the cost of a new single family home across York Region is about $790,000 now, which is really quite a concern. So again, if we look at the lack of rental options in York Region, part of our issue is that our vacancy rate, so with a tight supply, with a very tight market, it means that the vacancy rate is very, very low in comparison. It's below what we would consider healthy at about 3%, indicating a lack of movement, but it also puts pressure, upward pressure, on the costs of the rents and just the affordability of rental in general. In 2012, sort of the last year we have really good solid data, out of the 10,570 housing starts that were in play across York Region, about 270 of them were for the rental market, and 237 of those were actually built by the region's housing company, Housing York. So only 33 rental, purpose-built rental units in a year across all of York Region is obviously a concern in terms of the choice. So one of the things that the Human Services Planning Board is focusing on is trying to create the conditions to get the private sector back to the table. And there's obviously a lot that needs to be done, and we can't do it alone, so we're trying to enlist as many voices and as much support as we possibly can to try to make that happen. So towards that end, Make Rental Happen advocacy plan was developed. It went to regional council. It was endorsed. There are basically three deliverables. We've also hired some government relations support to help make that happen. But pulling together the data, trying to get as many voices to speak to this issue as possible, getting statements of commitment and bringing the partners back to the table, talking to the building industry, the real estate industry, anyone we can think of that has a vested interest, seniors groups, even the chambers who are looking at this as actually a labor market issue and a difficulty in recruitment and retention issue. If the jobs are not high paying, and how do they attract the right workforce, and how do they keep that workforce and keep them from going elsewhere? So it does become a bit of a labor market issue and a bit of an economic issue for businesses. So again, it's about creating the choice and allowing people who, for whatever reason, may not want to buy a home. If you're a 20-something and you've just launched, a home may not be part of your plans and may not be affordable. If you're a senior, and I know Councillor Taylor has often commented that he gets regular emails from folks who are looking to downsize. They really, really want to stay in Newmarket, but they can't find anything to go to, and a basement apartment for a senior just might not be the right choice either. So there's all of those folks have an interest in trying to make sure that there is choice, in addition to our newcomers. And I think you may have seen a lot of data and reports coming your way in the past that speaks to the fact that newcomers are an important part of our growth in York Region and also an important part of our economy and our labor force. And often when newcomers come to an area, what they want to do is rent and get a lay of the land. So in terms of attracting newcomers, in terms of helping them integrate and so on, rental is an important option for them as well. So we're engaging all the levels of government, so the province, even the federal government, the building industry, and corporate leaders. And I wanted to highlight that IBM is a corporate partner around the Human Services Planning Board as well. So, in addition to raising awareness and trying to get common voices to work with us, we've also been taking some practical steps, and you may have seen some of them, in trying to, again, encourage a dialogue around housing. And one of them is during the National Housing Day back in the fall, back in November, there was a social media campaign just talking about rental housing. It has generated some interest. Social media was used to maximize our reach and generate dialogue. Facebook, Twitter, I think all of you are familiar with those. We continue to use the hashtag #MakeRentalHappen. And as of Friday, there was a housing symposium where the building industry and others came to the table. And so, again, continuing to raise awareness and bring people along with us to encourage the development of housing. We also, as part of all of this, hosted the Make Rental Happen Student Challenge, and it was a contest that was put out to all post-secondary students, whether college or university, across Canada and the U.S., and we had a number of submissions and prizes were awarded because we thought, housing and affordable rental housing is something of interest to that generation, but perhaps they have thought of some things that we hadn't in the past. And so we got some wonderful ideas, and the winning entry was actually a brother team from the University of Guelph who won the first prize of $5,000. We're also looking at creating additional discussions, and we have had conversations with Town of Newmarket, and as I note on the agenda later on this evening, you're acting on that and looking at the development of rental housing, and that's where partners have also come together to try to develop rental housing. What were the barriers and how can we move past them? So local developer coming forward, a set of principles was adopted by the region to see what we could do, and I know it's on your agenda for tonight. We do plan on continuing to talk with the province and the federal government around seeing what can be done about tax laws, making it attractive to reinvest in multi-unit residential buildings, and also looking at the province and assessing the building code and various other things that might make the building of housing a little more cost effective for investors. So moving on and switching gears, that's the rental side of the equation. The other activity that the Human Services Planning Board was engaged in on the area of economic self-sufficiency, a project called the Fair Access Partnership. Now, because there are 24 agencies around the table, every agency is doing something, both internally and also in a collective partnership, and the Fair Access Partnership is one of those items. I do want to give thanks to Ian McDougall, who was around our table for a period of time, and Colin Service from Newmarket, who continues to work on the Fair Access Partnership. And basically, it is it's a collaboration between the partners, and it really is aimed at, you heard our last delegation talk about the benefits of healthy activity and recreation and so on, and I know this council is very familiar with all of those things, but it really is an attempt to try to make recreation services more accessible and affordable for low and moderate income families. And so
I have you at on slide 9. I'll just ask a motion for an additional 5 minutes for you. So can I have a motion? Okay. Councillor Kerwin, Councillor Twinney, all those in favor? Thank you. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, I'm coming to the end or getting close. So in terms of a partnership, that marriage of recreation, so the local municipalities have a lot of expertise and a lot of services to offer when it comes to recreation. The schools and the school boards have the space. They also have the captive audience, and the region has played a facilitative role. So it really has been a partnership approach with all 9 local municipalities. We've started off with 4 pilot areas, and the town of Newmarket is one of them. Coming to the table to make recreation happen. A neighborhood approach was taken in regards to this, and so it means that not only is the program available to kids that actually go to that particular school, but also the kids that might be in a neighborhood school that might be in a catchment area. And we looked at neighborhoods that had maybe a Catholic and a public school that were within walking distance of each other, so the kids in the neighborhood could actually attend the program there. There was lots of planning. Everything has come together. I'll talk a little bit about the MOU, which is about to be finalized. But for the town of Newmarket, the school is Alexander Muir. And we heard again the last delegation, Canadian Martyrs, is part of the catchment of that area. And this program will be available to them as well. So I mentioned all of that. So the working group, when it got set up, neighborhood selection was an important part. The program is pretty much done in all four pilot sites. That has been decided on. Memorandum of understanding, because we do need to paper these things in an adequate way. Fees and charges, very, very affordable. I think most of the pilot sites are actually about a $5 a day charge, and there's subsidy available for families who find that even that is a hardship. So all of those decisions have been made. And so, generally speaking, the program concept, there's supposed to be a healthy, active living piece to it, learn some new skills, some homework support potentially, but especially fun and recreation and active fun. And so that has all come together. The target group is the grade 6 to 8 group, because they've tended to not get they don't like to go to the little kids after school programs, and yet there's a need for this particular target group, aged 11 to 14. Each neighborhood, there was data that was collected that would make them a good target site in terms of economic issues, in terms of perhaps English as a second language issues if it's a newcomer neighborhood, and surveys were done in the neighborhood to determine what should the program be. And so it was the kids and the families that spoke around what they'd like to see in each of those areas. So again, the draft memorandum of understanding has been done, and it's being circulated across the pilot areas and being implemented. Again, I think the return on investment is pretty self-explanatory. Healthy, active movement for the kids, safe place for them to be after school, and affordability for the parents, but also, more importantly, building community and building neighborhood and building spirit. And so at the end of the day, with those two things in mind, looking at the issue of rental and how we can all work together, I know it says up on the slide asking you to endorse the plan, but I think really, in all honesty, it's about continuing doing what you've been doing all along on both fronts, on the rental and on the recreation piece. And continuing to provide the staff resources to continue to support it and to continue to be a partner around the table. And even more importantly, asking that you share this story and share the support for the development of rental and also recreation with all of your networks, all of your friends, colleagues, constituents, et cetera. And that's it.
Thank you. There's questions of clarification. Councillor Emanuel?
Thank you. Adelina, thank you so much for your presentation through you, Mr. Mayor. This is especially, I think, the Make Rental Happen piece. It's exciting. And it's so important. You know, one of the things I've come across, and people I've gone to university or high school with, university with, it's very difficult to come back to a community like Newmarket and establish yourself. And as you said, the average region-wide house price is over $700,000. We consider affordable over $400,000. So having rental options, and the key word is purpose-built.
Yes.
Because what ends up happening, we see Toronto, while there's lots of opportunities with condo investors and things like that, mm-hmm. It creates an artificial market, and it actually adds to the cost. So to have the purpose-built, and not anything, not to be negative, but not everyone wants to live in a basement apartment, and sometimes they want attractive rental opportunities. So this is so crucial. And I sat on the board of FCM for 3 years, and there's no doubt about it. FCM and the communities across country recognize York Region as a leader here. So thank you to your staff, and also the regional councillor Taylor and Mayor Van Bynen for your work at the region, as well as the Human Services Planning Coalition. This is so important. But we also can't do it ourselves either. And I think municipalities are a factor, but I would suggest that the federal government, with respect to the tax laws, as you indicated, the provincial government, with respect to rent control policies, they have a huge impact on this. And this is so important for our communities going forward, that purpose-built rental. So just thank you for all you do on this file. But it's one thing is very clear. York Region is leading in this regard. And it's because of efforts like yourself and the Human Services Planning Coalition. So thank you.
Thank you. Councillor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thanks for the presentation. I certainly appreciate your efforts and the region's efforts in looking at a very serious problem with rental options in York Region. I think we are a very expensive place to live. But my question to you, and I have a few, You said you were looking for support from other municipalities, and I know that you present to all the other eight municipalities besides ourselves. I do recall, and I could be wrong, but maybe you can help me, was there some sort of a quota for the region as to what percentage, I mean, what share, what their fair share of rental units in every municipality? That's my first question.
Yeah. Mr. Mayor, no, there's no quota per se, and the statistics that we've gathered and what I've quoted tonight is region-wide. We do have statistics broken down by municipality, and again, municipalities like the town of Newmarket that has had secondary suites and those bylaws in place for a while are a little bit further ahead of the game because there is that ability. Some of the other local municipalities are just examining the issue or have debated it but aren't quite ready to go there, but the official plan requires that there be policies in place around secondary suites. So we do have some data by local municipality, but I haven't presented it here tonight, but no, there's no quota.
Okay, so maybe quota wasn't the right word, but you did say that there is an official plan that requires all municipalities to have some sort of a plan in place. And what I wanted to know, and you said you don't have statistics with you, but I know the statistics not off the top of my head, but I can say how does Newmarket compare currently to the other municipalities in terms of rental housing as we stand?
Yeah,
it varies. Again, because of the secondary suites, for instance, in some of the municipalities where the bylaws haven't been passed, we know that those units are out there. They're just not legal and they're not registered, and it's questionable as to whether some of them are safe or not. But across all of York Region, we have such a supply issue that there really isn't one local municipality, and some have very, very little. Like if I were to look at in King Township as an example, there's very, very little rental housing at all. And any rental housing that exists, for instance, in the Nobleton area, an area I'm very familiar with, is social housing, and it was downloaded from the province. So different municipalities are at different places in terms of whether they have rental stock or not, and some of it depends on when the development of that local municipality took place. So one of the reasons why York Region across the board has such a low percentage is that when rental housing was being developed and was built, mostly by the private sector, it was a time that favored it, and those municipalities were already growing. And York Region, of course, was very new. It hadn't quite developed yet. It was going to be growing, but it hadn't developed at the time that all of that was taking place. And then the legislation changed, the investment opportunities changed, and it just didn't happen in York Region. So our percentage is very low compared to municipalities that were growing maybe 10 or 20 years ahead of us.
Right. So when you say rental stock, though, I'm not really referring to the, you know, basement dwellings. I'm talking about the actual, you know, rental housing that we have. And I know for a fact that Newmarket is pretty high up there compared to the other municipalities. In fact, you said that yourself, that certain municipalities, the bigger ones, Vaughan, Markham, don't have a lot of catching up to do. So I would certainly hope, in all fairness, I don't think I'm being out of line when I say that in fairness to all of the municipalities that we should have that same rate of rental housing as opposed to concentrating it on a certain area. That's my big issue there. The other thing you mentioned is you said that conditions for the private sector to get back are needed to get back to the table. And, you know, you are working with the building and the real estate industry. And so I guess, I mean, and this is more of a comment than anything else, but, and I think you know what I'm about to say, is that we have, you know, I know that York Region just recently, maybe a year ago or 2 years ago, I can't remember, increased their development charges. Mm-hmm. And we today at Town of Newmarket will be doing the same thing. We spoke about that this afternoon, and that's upcoming. So I guess it is a bit of a conundrum there. So you've got this situation where we are building up and, you know, we have these big investments with condos, and yet how does a developer, what incentive do they have to come in and make rental? And I understand, and I really do appreciate your creativity. You've certainly been thinking out of the box and how that happens, but you understand that it's a bit of a different philosophy that we have. We're doing one thing, we're saying another.
Adelina?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, to some extent, you're absolutely right, Councillor DiMuccio. I mean, there's been, part of it is because of our history with how much home ownership has guided the decision making as opposed to rental and the development of other kinds of housing. And we've heard actually at the housing symposium that we had on Friday, the whole financing package relating to developing rental versus developing condos is a very different thing. And so if you look at the development of rental, for instance, that developer has to basically foot the entire bill through borrowing and his own cash and so on up front. In the development and the marketing of a condo, you pre-sell a certain number of units, and when you do that, you can go to the bank to borrow. And so part of that, though, is that you don't have to borrow as much because people have given you money against the unit that you're going to purchase. So the whole financing, and that's the very simplistic version, there are a lot of other things that come into play, including the taxing of it. But the very nature in which a rental building occurs is very different than the way a condo building occurs. And so periodically we do have developers, and the one that we talked about in this pilot, come to the table and say, you know, we know there's a need, we know there's a market for rental housing, but here is what we'd like to see you do. Here's how you can help. And so that's why Regional Council, we went to Council and we outlined some principles. We couldn't give a lot away, but for instance, in this particular case, even the deferral of development charges so that they could be put off until there's cash flow coming into the building was a way that it was going to help this developer actually make the project and the financing work. So sometimes it's little things like that. Sometimes it's the timing in terms of how long it takes for processes and applications to get through the system. So we knew that there are tools that local municipalities, the region, have at their disposal that they can choose to make decisions on and make some adjustments to. We do have to get at provincial and the federal levels of government, though, to make that environment easier.
Thank you.
It's still difficult.
I still have two other councillors in the queue, Councillor Twinney and then Councillor Sponda.
Thank you. Just more of a comment, and I just want to thank you for coming tonight. But was at the symposium on Friday. It was very informative. Certainly a lot of information, and I've heard from my residents, many residents within this whole area, about how excited they are about the new proposal of this rental purpose built on Davis Drive. And I think, you know, me and as a council, that we need to continue down these roads of thinking of ways to encourage more purpose-built rentals. I think, there's a number of lots of seniors out there, mm-hmm. Young people who, these wonderful residents that we have now that in our community, are quite expensive. So, there's a lot of seniors out there that are looking to downsize and would like to have the ability to move into a nice rental. So I think it's really important for us, for our community, to make sure that we have that ability to keep residents here living here in Newmarket as opposed to mm-hmm. looking elsewhere, moving further north where perhaps it's cheaper. So I think there's lots that we can continue to do, and I'm looking forward to being part of that. So thank you, and it was a great day on Friday. So thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Sponda.
First of all, thank you, Adelina, for the presentation, and I'll take this opportunity to express my gratitude to the Human Services Board, Councillor Taylor, Councillor La Rosa, for some wonderful work. As the council for the oldest part of town, I find myself often being asked by residents of the ward that are tenants in substandard units to negotiate with their landlords to have certain issues fixed, rather than go to the tenant-landlord tribunal because they know they're going to get evicted and they know they can't find accommodations within Newmarket of the similar size. Just recently, this winter, some residents followed me on Facebook where I was called to one apartment. The roof had caved into one of the rooms, yet the tenant didn't want to move because single mom with four children, and she didn't think she could find an 1,100-square-foot apartment with three bedrooms for $1,000. And she was probably right, and she'd rather lock up one of the rooms and live in the rest of the apartment until the landlord finished the repairs rather than and put up with the mold in the kitchen and not call the region rather than look for another apartment. Also, as the chair of the food bank, on several occasions I speak to the clients of the food bank, And there was an interesting article on food security from the Food Network, actually, York Region Food Network this week. And yes, it'd be nice to make food banks obsolete, but at the end of the day, a lot of these people that are in our municipality and some of the surrounding municipalities find that by the time they've put their kids to school, they've clothed themselves, and paid rent, that there's no money for a certain item of food. So we also kind of have to come to the realization, maybe not to the same extremes, that we have a very large portion of our population that still either works at retail at either minimum or just above minimum wage, or even some of the manufacturing facilities. There are just, you know, lower wages. And at $11 or $12 an hour, there's no way you can afford a $700,000 or $600,000 home. And you're going to have a very hard time paying $1,500 a month rent as well. So it's a very urgent topic, and I'm glad that the region and the Human Services Board is dealing with the issue, because it could become a crisis, and I believe it is a crisis, right? If you have a 0% vacancy rate, and we want these people to live close to where they work, and we're going to find ourselves, like you said earlier, in a labor market crisis where it's going to be very difficult to attract people to work in a retail or a manufacturing if they have to come from Barrie or if they have to come from, you know, other municipalities where housing is more affordable. So kudos to you. It's a much needed work, and absolutely, as far as I'm concerned, I think we should stay on board and continue to help.
Thank you. Regional Councillor.
Adelina, thanks for the presentation. And this is a this is an area I've become extremely engaged in over the last year or two, and I've become quite passionate about. You know, when we talk about who rents or fair share, you know, of renting and renters, you know, at the conference I asked, and you could ask in any room at any time, for people to put up their hands if they've ever rented. And firstly, every hand in the room will go up. So when we're talking about renters, it's all of us. And if it's not us, it's going to be our children or it's going to be our parents. And to have a complete community, we need to have adequate rental housing. And again, when we talk about who's getting their fair share of rental housing, well, no one is. In the last 10 years, less than 200 units, and this is in a region of 1 million people with 25,000 new residents a year, in the last 10 years, 200 rental units, purpose-built rental units, have come online. So nobody's getting any share of rental housing. This is an extremely important area that we have to work on. It's not necessarily a popular one, but it's an important one if we're going to have a complete community that looks at and includes everyone. And I'll just close with this example. We had Tim Hortons Camp Day the other day, and some of us volunteered at Tim Hortons. I think most of us did. And I was at one of the Tim Hortons, and I was put on making coffee, not serving it, making it, which was beyond my skill set. And I had a young single mom who was helping me for the time I was there, and we were chatting, and she was, you know, basically doing it for me because she was so good at what she was doing. But the real important part of the story was, as I got to talk with her that day, and discovered that she has been working at the Tim Hortons in Newmarket for 3 years, and she lives in Barrie and takes the GO bus here every day. That's not sustainable in any way. So I think this is something that I'm glad we're working hard on. I'm glad we're making progress on, and we are making progress, and we'll continue to make progress. And thank you for bringing the presentation to us.
It might be appropriate for you to motion to receive. Okay. Can I have a seconder for that? Okay. Councillor Emmanuel. Final comments, please, Councillor DeMuchos.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I know we're not talking about subsidized housing, but I actually just did some research here while I was listening. And I got this information from the York Region website. But just to make it very clear, there is... I'm just looking at the breakdown here of percentages of subsidized housing across all 9 municipalities in York Region, and Newmarket has the highest percentage at 2.43%, and that would be the highest comparison to Aurora, which is 0.9%, and then followed by East Gwillimbury, 1.12%, Georgina 1.98%, King 1.37%, Markham 2%, very low, Richmond Hill 0.8%, Vaughan 0.2%. And so I guess my point is that when you say that, you know, we've mentioned the word fair share here, I think that we need to be very clear with all the municipal leaders in all of the regions that When it comes to affordability, I do in fact believe that every municipality does have to carry their weight. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. All those in favor of the motion? And opposed, and that is carried. Thank you very much, Adelina. You've been doing great work at the, everybody needs to remember to press their buttons. You've been doing great work since your arrival at the region, and the progress is self-evident. So congratulations on what you're doing. Our next deputant is Ms. Karen Hamalainen. Karen? We permit up to 5 minutes for a presentation.
Mr. Mayor and councillors, the subject of my deputation is the feasibility of the Good Coin program. I'd like to begin by saying that I have found very little public information on this subject, so please correct any information that is inaccurate. I will be speaking to you today in response to Mr. Ferguson's presentation at Council May 26 regarding the Good Coin program. This program aims to provide Southlake with new medical equipment while providing incentive to conserve hydro. I must say, by using Southlake, especially targeting pediatric care, seems a marketing gem. On the surface, who could deny the value of this program? Yet Southlake and hospital equipment fall in the sphere of provincial responsibilities. The municipality in the past already burdened property taxpayers with a hospital tax levy that fell outside the town's sphere of responsibilities. Now members of the board of Newmarket Tay Hydro, which include Mayor Tony Van Bryan, former Mayor Tom Taylor, the mayor from Tay Township, Paul Ferguson, and three other board members, seem to have gone ahead contracting the services of the tech firm Zero Footprints to implement the firm's Good Coins program. Not knowing the financial commitment to Zero Footprints, I was equally curious as to where the funds to purchase the hospital equipment were to come from. Councillor DiMuccio asked Mr. Ferguson, and the reply was that it would be funded by the utility, and that is where issues arise. The idea of providing anyone who enters the program with a free smart thermostat is highly unethical. In essence, the program forces seniors or those on fixed incomes to compensate via their hydro bill those ratepayers that can well afford to pay for their own smart thermostat. The town must recognize that those living on fixed incomes are already doing all they can to keep their bills down out of necessity. The cost of acquiring the services of Zero Footprints, purchasing and installation of smart thermostats, cost of data analysis, cost of medical equipment, cost of bureaucracy required to run this program will negate any individual savings from conserving electricity. What is left is a program to fund Southlake through our hydro utility. I'm asking Council to rethink its position and remember those standing in line at the Newmarket Food Pantry or seniors choosing between medications or food. These people will be adversely affected if we continue this program. Attempts to control and lower usage could easily be attained by a tiered usage system, a much fairer system of rewarding those that conserve. Clearly, the hydro utility is a provider of energy, not a means of funding or fundraising for any entity, and especially not for the shortfall of provincial funding. Fundraising charities should target those with the means while not burdening the disadvantaged. We already have a level of government that is tasked to oversee our hospitals. For council to intervene is to duplicate services and provide a slippery slope to download more services. I respectfully ask you to review the decision to proceed.
Thank you. As it happens, we do have Mr. Ferguson as the president of Newmarket Tay Hydro as a subsequent deputation. Unless there's questions of clarification, I'll ask for a motion to receive the deputation. Councillor Manuel, Councillor Sponga, all those in favor?
That
is carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, yes. Technology, again. Click the buttons. Thanks for the reminder, Mr. Clerk. Mr. Ferguson, if you could come forward, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of council. First, I would like to thank Mrs. Hamalainen for her voicing her concerns. She raises legitimate questions that others may share, and I welcome the opportunity to provide answers to them. Both Peak Saver Plus Smart Thermostat and Good Coins campaign are energy conservation programs. Many studies show that energy conservation more than pays for itself in terms of the avoided costs to the electricity system. In fact, the Ontario Ministry of Energy estimates that for every dollar we spend in electricity efficiency and conservation, Ontario avoids about $2 in the cost for generating new electricity. New Market Hydro does not fund the Peak Saver Plus Smart Thermostat. It's a province-wide program funded by the Ontario Power Authority's conservation program. The thermostat is able to make a small adjustment to a home's air conditioner during hot summer days when the demand for electricity is very high. So it reduces the need for extra generation to meet those peaks. That is the savings that the thermostat produces not only pays for the thermostat, but it also reduces the overall cost for electricity for everyone. No one, including seniors or people on fixed incomes, are disadvantaged in any way. The more they actually benefit from the reduced cost of electricity that these thermostats create. The more thermostats we install, the greater the benefit. In reality, it may be unethical not to offer the Peak Saver Plus program to the residents of Newmarket. The Good Coins is a social engagement program targeting electricity. Again, studies show, and the Ontario government has mandated, that behavioral change strategies related to electricity conservation are viable and effective. Increasing consumer awareness and encouraging different behavior is one of the most effective ways to get consumers to reduce energy use through, for example, social benchmarking. The Good Coins program is intended to engage residents in understanding their electricity use and managing it. I appreciate we're all doing everything we can to try and keep our electricity bill down and use less, but are we really doing a good job of it? And I'm honest, I for one, I'm not sure, as I only have a monthly bill to look at. Now I have a worthy cause to work with and the ability to monitor the electricity I'm using at any time. I know I will learn much, much more about conservation in my home. Similar to the Peak Saver Plus program, this will not only help me conserve electricity, it will also contribute to reducing the cost of electricity for everyone. We have a tiered usage pricing system in place. We've had it in place for about 5 years. We were the first utility in the province to move customers to time of use pricing. Through the Good Coins program, we want residents to better understand the time of use and take advantage of it wherever possible. The South Lake funding is in the form of a corporate donation. This is in no way a tax levy, and it is incorrect to suggest that it is. The donation is a one-time payment based on the success of the pilot. It is not primarily about giving money to South Lake. It is about getting consumers interested enough to consider a commitment to behavioral change when it comes to electricity conservation. The Peak Saver Plus and Good Coins program will not increase electricity bills at all, and no consumers will be adversely affected. They only stand to benefit from these programs. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. I appreciate you taking the time to clarify those statements as well. Questions of clarification, Councillor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thanks for your presentation, Paul. I certainly brought this up last time we were introduced to the project, and I noticed that I'm just looking at your deputation, which I have in writing here, and the last meeting you were talking about a lot of the funding and how that was where it was coming from, and I don't think you had answers, but I noticed you've really downplayed it this time, and what you've mostly talked about is the Peak Saver program and the smart thermostat. Now, I will be the first person at this table to say that this is a fantastic idea. I think any incentive that gets us to save conservation and have this machine tell us when we're using too much is a brilliant thing. I think it's wonderful. And I don't pretend to speak for Ms. Karen Hamilayan. I don't know if I pronounced that correctly. But I got the impression that I think she was more focused on the funding part of it. And you had mentioned in the last council meeting that the funding, just so the people understand, there is a pilot project going on, and people who use the least amount of energy, there's going to be some special funding available to South Lake Hospital to purchase a machine, I believe, some sort of equipment. And I think that was the crux of Ms. Karen's deputation tonight. So you had said that the funding was that you had four partners, and three of those partners, Town of Newmarket, South Lake, Newmarket Te Hydro, and IBM.
That is
okay. So I guess my question tonight, you say that the South Lake funding is in the form of a corporate donation, and my question to you is, who is that donor?
Sorry?
Who is the corporate donor?
Newmarket Te Power.
Okay, so here's the problem I have. I think there's a confusion here with a public utility company and a private corporation. And I know that you look at yourself as a private corporation, but I don't. I look at you as a public utility, and I look at you as the funds are coming out of people that are using the public utility. So I'm not sure how that you would call yourself a corporate donation. It's not.
It is. We are. We are a corporation.
You are a corporation.
We are held by a municipal shareholder. So, we do corporate donations, not just to South Lake, but to other worthy causes in town.
Okay, so where's the funding? The funding is coming from who? The users of the utility,
The
right?
funding comes from the utility, from retained earnings, the same way as Enbridge makes corporate donations, as Bell makes corporate donations, as Hydro One makes corporate donations. Okay, the benefit is to give back to the community. The other benefit is a savings in the corporate taxes we pay.
Okay, but so I'm not, yeah.
And here, whether it's South Lake or another worthy cause, the goal of the donation is to engage the consumer and engage the consumer in energy conservation. That is our goal.
And I think it's a great goal. And my problem is this. You have a wonderful program, but you wanted to throw in the corporate donation, and I appreciate that. And I certainly know that you donate. You know, the town of Newmarket donates as well. That comes from taxpayers. Your donation, your corporate donation, comes from public, from users of the utility that we buy into. So I guess that's where our philosophical beliefs,
and whether we make the corporate donation or not, will not change the consumer's bill at all.
And I agree with you, and I don't think it will either, Paul, because I know that you have budgeted for that. But I guess my point is that, and I don't speak for Karen, but I think her question was the wisdom of using that those dollars for that kind of funding, and is it in the best interest of the people that are buying into the utility that they use? I mean, that's quite that you could agree yes, some of us could agree yes, and others no. But I guess that was what Karen was saying.
Thank you, Councillor.
One more thing, Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to know your opinion. Is it not a conflict of interest to have these decisions made by someone who sits currently on council, who sits also on South Lake Hospital Board and Newmarket Te Hydro Board? I'm just curious as to how these things come to. I just think that it's a conflict of interest when you have one member of council who sits on both boards and who's making these kinds of decisions with utility rates. I'm sorry, that's just how I feel.
The choice of the donation, was my decision.
Sorry. Yes. Point of order. It's not appropriate to ask the deputant about conflicts of interest.
That's true.
That's not an appropriate position for the president of our hydro
corporation. Well,
that's
correct. Free to answer
Mr.
the
Mayor,
question.
Sorry, yes. Councillor Dimitri, you can't interrupt me.
Yes. And
the
so
mayor
the,
can rule on my point of order. Thank you.
And your point of order is correct, Paul. There's no need for that, for you to respond. And the reality is that we've got some very clear guidelines about what a conflict of interest is. And as a matter of interest, my participation with South Lake is voluntary, and it's an appointment that comes out of the region. My participation with Hydro is as a result of the shareholders agreement in which I'm the mayors of both municipalities are appointed to Hydro. And so that conflict will exist for, if that's a conflict in, at all, would exist for all mayors. But more importantly, I think it's great to see that your mayor is engaged in all of these different activities, representing the municipality. Isn't that, in fact, what he's elected for? And that's, in fact, what he is doing. So to suggest that it's improper, I think, is totally inappropriate. But nonetheless, I think we'll move on. I'll entertain a motion to receive Mr. Ferguson's.
Well, no, Mr. Mayor, I think in fairness, it's fair for me to reply to what you just said.
Well, let's,
and
yeah,
my job,
do...
Mr. Mayor, as a member of this board and as elected
Counselor?
Official, I'm in the queue. I'm sorry,
I know you're
but I'm
in the queue,
and I'm responding.
But we're off.
No. Okay, so you're cutting me off of the queue, so I can't respond to you?
I did respond. You would ask the question, the response was there, Councillor.
And I think you misunderstood what I was saying when I asked you, when I challenged you, Mr. Mayor. I'm still in the queue. And my response to you is, sir, that you may feel that it's not a conflict of interest, but other people may feel it is. So now that we have it on the record, I appreciate that. So thank you for your answer.
Motion to receive their deputation. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel, all those in favor? That's right.
Thank you.
Remember that happened? And, okay, thank you. That is carried. Okay, next item is the approval of minutes. Council minutes, May 26th. Are there any corrections, errors, or omissions? Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel, all those in favor? Wait for the button. Thank you. We do not have any correspondence. We do have a petition, and that is item number 16. So we'll deal with that under item number 16. Reports from regional representatives. Regional councillor.
Thanks very much. Just briefly, I want to mention that at regional council, we have moved forward the Markham official plan and the Vaughan secondary plan, and those are two important documents that were finalizing this week. I wanted to mention, it's been just touched on, but I do want to mention that we had the housing, the rental housing symposium on Friday. We had about 150, 170 people in attendance with speakers from Vancouver and Toronto and private and public sector, and it was an excellent day with some great discussion and great presentations, and we'll continue to move that forward. And finally, I just want to touch on, although I think many people probably are aware, but people are starting to hear it throughout the day, that York University has made the announcement of its choice for a post-secondary location to move forward, and it's, they've chosen Markham Center as their preferred location to move forward with the province. Of course, some time ago, we were somewhat disappointed that we didn't see a location chosen here in the Newmarket-Aurora area in the northern central portion of the region, but this is nonetheless very exciting news to see the region moving forward in partnership with York Region and Markham, and the possibility and the opportunity that one day my children or other people's children will be able to attend a university here in York Region and not have to travel farther away. And certainly that is an incredibly important issue when we're talking about affordability for some families and making sure that those kinds of options are available. So very exciting to see this. I hope you know, we're all cheering and behind this effort and hoping that they're successful as they go forward to the province. Thank you.
Thank you. Reports of committees and staff. We'll start with item number 8, Special Committee of the Whole Minutes of May 26th. That's with respect to the development charges review. Thank you. Councillor Emanuel, seconder. Councillor Kerwin, any discussion? All those in favor? That is carried. And we press the buttons. Thank you. Next item number 8 is the council workshop record of June the 9th. Motion to receive. Councillor Emanuel, Councillor DiMuccio, all those in favor? Councillor Hampton? And that is carried. Thank you. Next item is Special Committee of the Whole Minutes, June 16th, and that was regarding the potential disposition acquisition of land by the municipality. Thank you. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel. All those in favor? Any opposed? We'll wait for the button. Good. That is carried. Thank you. Next item is the Special Committee of the Whole closed session of June the 16th. Councillor Sponga, seconded by Councillor Emanuel. All those in favor? To the minutes, because we'll be dealing with the individual items following that. That's what we're
just accepting the minutes,
that's what we'll do. It's okay. On the agenda. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Okay. All those in favor? Any opposed? That is carried. Thank you. First item number one out of the minutes of the Special Committee of the Whole is with respect to the potential disposition of land. Could I have a motion, please, that the Joint Chief Administration Officer, Commissioner of Development and Infrastructure Services, and the Commissioner of Community Services closed report of number 2014-41 regarding the Hollingsworth Arena be received, and that staff be directed to proceed as authorized at the June 16th Special Committee of the Whole. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Vey, all those in favor? Any opposed? Thank you. That's item number one with that report. The second item within that, the minutes of that meeting, item number two is report number 2014-27, potential acquisition by the municipality of land in Ward 5. Could I have a motion, please, that the Development and Infrastructure Services Planning and Building Services closed report number 2014-27 regarding the strategic acquisition of land by the municipality be received, and that staff be directed to proceed as authorized in the June 18th, 2014 Special Committee of the Whole closed session meeting. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel, all those in favor? That carries. Down to item number three of that meeting, and that is the, or did we deal with item number three? Okay. Item number three of that meeting then is the potential acquisition of land by the municipality in Ward 5, and I would ask for a motion then that the Joint Chief Administration Officer and Commissioner and Commissioner's closed report 2014-42 be received regarding the potential acquisition of property be received, and that the recommendations of the Joint Chief Administration Officer and Commissioner's closed session report be adopted. All those in favor? Mover and a seconder. Thank you. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel. Thank you. That's item number three. All those in favor? Okay, everybody's in. Next item is item number four, and that is the potential acquisition of land by the municipality in Ward 5. Could I have a motion then that the Joint Chief Administration Officer and Commissioner's closed session report number 2014-26 regarding strategic acquisition of land by the municipality be received, and that staff be directed to proceed as authorized at the June 16th, 2014 Special Committee of the Whole closed session meeting. Could I have a motion? Mover and a seconder, please. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Hampen. All those in favor? Any opposed? And that is carried. The final item is item number five, and that is with respect to the potential acquisition of land by the municipality in Ward 6. Could I have a motion, please, then, that the report number 2014-14 be received, and that the recommendations in the Joint Chief Administration Officer and Commissioner's closed session report 2014-14 be adopted. Councillor DiMuccio, Councillor Emmanuel. All those in favor? That is carried. I believe that deals with all of the matters that are contained in the June 16th. That was the 10 a.m. session, yes. There was a subsequent meeting that day as well. Okay, so then we have the special, that was item number 10 that we dealt with. Item number 11 is the Committee of the Whole minutes of June the 16th. Councilor Emmanuel, Councilor Sponga. Any items to be dealt with separately? Councilor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just one item from my end, and that is item 27, please.
Declarations. We also have we have some declarations, so we'll deal with item number 27 separately, site plan approval, and I believe the declarations. It's June the 16th. We'll deal with item number 30. Is it item number 30? Yes, item number 31. Separately, and I believe it's item number 36. Item number 36, and we'll deal with that so that we'll enable Councillor Kempen to vote on items that are not related to the properties that he has declared an interest in. That's item number 36, right? Okay. So we'll deal with item number 27, 31, and 36 separately. Can I have we have a motion to deal with the balance of the agenda. Is that not correct? Regional Councillor?
Thanks. I think I heard you say you're dealing with 36 separately due to conflict, but just because sometimes we move quickly in that circumstance, I also want to speak to the item.
Okay. Certainly. Thank you. Councillor Sponga.
Yes, I'd like to briefly speak to item number 7, Mr. Mayor.
And we'll deal with item 7 separately then as well. Okay. Could I then have the motion is already on the table, right? And we'll exclude items number 27, 31, 36, and item number 7. All those in favor? Here we are. If everyone could vote, please. Regional Councillor, Councillor Twinney. Okay, thank you. And that is carried. Thank you. As a matter of interest, when we're dealing with item number 36, we can deal with it there, but it's also coming forward to us as item number 17, which is the secondary plan. So we could deal with it there and adopt the recommendations that bring it forward to this report. So item number 17 is the Urban Center Secondary Plan. And in addition to that, we also have some other correspondence. So, okay, let's deal with item number 7 of the Committee of the Whole.
Move the recommendation.
Councillor Sponga. Councillor Kerwin. Okay. Councillor Sponga is the mover.
Yeah, just briefly want to speak to the item. This item is recommending that the town of Newmarket engage in a traffic mitigating study and policy. We have it's been identified, it's no news to anyone that traffic is not the number one, definitely up there, traffic issues within our municipality. One of the biggest issues that people areas of concern in our with our residents. And I just want to take the time to thank the residents of the Ward 5 Traffic Safety Committee, which is co-chaired by Nancy Fish and Bob Quapis. Those are the folks that are responsible for the Give Your Kids a Break signs you see all over the neighborhood in Newmarket and as far south as Markham, I understand. Kudos to them because they were able to put together a ad hoc committee and made a very compelling case to the town and to council for engaging in this exercise. And please, summer is here upon us. There's a lot of events in town. There's a lot of pedestrians and a lot of kiddies kicking soccer balls around right about now. So please give kids a break and slow down. So thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councilor Kerwin, as the seconder.
What we have here is an overall look at the town, Mr. Mayor. It's just not putting a speed hump there and a speed hump there. And as Councilor Emanuel pointed out, that probably we've had 99 requests for speed humps all across the town, and it just doesn't behoove us to put that many speed humps in. So finally, we have a comprehensive plan to look at traffic, and I think we're moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussions? All those in favor? Item number 7. That is carried. Item number 27, that's with respect to the site plan approval for 17150. Could I have a motion to, with respect to the recommendations? Councillor Emanuel, second to Councillor Sponga. Councillor Emanuel, speaking to the motion as the mover.
Yeah, just briefly, this is the annex. It's the proposed new building that will be built at Yonge and Eagle to accommodate, I guess, you can probably, you and the regional council can probably better speak to it, but bringing together our regional staff from throughout the town and the region and consolidating into a new building that I know, and again, you can both speak to it better, but it will save considerably financially for the taxpayers on an operating basis. But this is the site plan. I just want to again express my appreciation to Region for hosting this, but also dealing with many of the resident concerns that I spoke to that night. A lot of them were traffic related, and very confident. I believe they've engaged Marshall McLemonahan to deal with traffic infiltration issues, et cetera, and confident they'll resolve some of the concerns raised by residents. Thank you.
Thank you. And the seconder?
No comments, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor DiMuccio?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As you said in the last meeting, you had asked me to, I had voted against this, and you had asked me to stick to the site application, which I understand is legislative process here that we have to do. But I was basing my decision on the philosophy of the project, and then you had, council had a robust discussion about that. This is a building that it's an addition that's going to cost in excess of over $200 million. And I understand that, you know, the concept of consolidating, we have other places that we run programs all over York Region. They just want to consolidate that in one building. You know, I didn't think we needed to fix that. I think that was okay. There's a big benefit to the economy when we, you know, when we're investing in rentals. But anyways, I know that some of the logic here is, you know, we're saving money down the line, but I think that it's fair to say that anytime you build, when you build infrastructure, when you're building that, there's enormous cost to maintain that down the line. So that's why I won't be supporting the plan. I think it's growing government, and I'm fundamentally against that. Thank you.
Thank you. Regional Councillor?
Thanks very much. This is a step forward for the regional annex building, and I guess the long and the short of it is that the region is growing rapidly, very rapidly. It's the fourth fastest growing census division in Canada. The province has given mandated growth targets. The growth target by 2041 will be 1.8 million people from the current 1.1 million people. That's a 700,000 person growth. So if you were to start a new town and have 700,000 people but have no office space from which to run government, I think you'd find it a little difficult. to do that. So you're going to, the municipality is going to grow significantly. You're going to have to provide the services to support those residents, whether they're planning services or health and community and social services. The other important point to remember here is these are jobs. These are 1,000 current jobs that will remain in the town of Newmarket. This was a unanimous decision of council, and I think it's safe to say that every town would have liked to have had this building in their community and these 1,000 high-quality jobs. And it's anticipated to go to 1,400 or 1,500 jobs over the time period span that 2031, 2041. So that's additional new jobs that communities are often striving to achieve high-quality jobs. Finally, as was alluded to by Councillor DiMuccio, the region wanted to be sure that this was the correct direction to go in. It is a big move forward. Of course, you are investing in land and an asset. I guess it might be like a person having a business, a shop across town, a repair shop, and a house, and they realize they could consolidate that in one location and have a lower cost, and so they go ahead and do that. And in this case, we wanted to be sure of this logic because there's many, many leased properties throughout the town and around Newmarket. And so we engaged KPMG, a very reputable firm, and they came to the conclusion that at the bare minimum, at their lowest, at their safest scenario, that the region would save $26 million by going in this direction. So although it is a site plan, the topic was raised about whether this is a wise direction or not. I think given the savings to the taxpayers, given the job retention and the job creation, I think this is a very positive direction for the town of Newmarket, and I do support it.
Thank you. Councillor Kerwin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was quoted in the air as we're very, very lucky in the first instance to have the original York Region Center in Newmarket, and we have some visionary former members of this council who attracted it here because it might not have come to Newmarket. It could have gone to Markham, it could have gone to Vaughan, could have gone to Richmond Hill, but we had people who sat on this council who fought passionately to have that building located here, and it was a controversial issue, no question about it, the architecture and the overruns and so forth, but when it was finished, we were lucky to have it here, and many, many people who live in this town can walk to work or even commute a very short distance to that building. And if you look at Luke Sagar, he bikes. A lot of people bike, a lot of people walk. I've seen them do that. But secondly, we're lucky to have the annex. Who knows, it might have gone somewhere else, but it's here in Newmarket. And once again, it will employ a lot of people in the Newmarket area who do not have to commute to the city or do not have to commute to Markham or to Vaughan or somewhere else. So we are lucky, we're fortunate, but it wasn't always that way. It was good planning and resolution to attract the building in the first place and to build the annex in the second place.
Thank you. My views are very similar to what's been expressed. And the reality is that Newmarket functioning as a regional center is a strategic economic development priority of ours, and this fits perfectly with that. But having said that, the issue here was the design of the building, the placement of the building, and the appropriateness of the building, and that's been dealt with. The business case has been solved a long time ago. It stands on its own merits, and repeating and repeating ourselves is not a productive use of our time. So I'll call the question. All those in favor? That carries. Thank you. Next item is item number 31, and we're dealing with that because we have a declaration. We have a mover.
Move.
Councillor Sponga. Seconder. Councillor Emanuel. Any discussion? All those in favor? Councillor Vey. That carries. Thank you. Next item is item number 36, and as I mentioned, this item is also coming forward under item number 17, but I believe that the recommendations are to forward this to council for consideration. So could I have a mover and a seconder with respect to the recommendations that we arrived at the Committee of the Whole?
I'll make a motion.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'll move it, except I do want to correct it just for the record a little bit, and that's why I wanted to deal with it here as opposed to the more generic motion later. two things is that there's brackets binding, and it's minor, but I don't think that was meant to be bracketed, and perhaps it was the notes I provided, but that it's supposed to just be a binding. But the other part is that it says at the top that the plan be amended to include the following language, one and two, and I think it's meant to be include the following language, one, and then a separate recommendation, number two, which provides direction in terms of a process after the secondary plan, and I don't...
The motion, worry. Is it? The motion is an amendment? Is
so it? The motion, it would be that I move A1 as a single recommendation and two as a separate recommendation without the brackets on binding.
Now, what page are you on?
You wanted the motion.
Page 65. And that's A1.
You mean, Mr. Mayor, if you want to refer to the screen?
Oh, right here. Okay. Thank you. Okay, go ahead. Are those two? Okay. Now, do we have a seconder for that, for the motion as amended? Councillor Sponga. Okay. Speaking to it as the mover, Regional Councillor?
This is just a technical correction. Thanks.
Councillor Sponga? Okay. Thank you. Councillor Mucho?
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to clear, I'm just looking at the screen, so we are just voting on the amendment, not the general. This is just one part of it. Okay, thank you.
I think the intent is to move the recommendations forward with those amendments. Is that not correct?
That's correct, but I think it's still, yes, that is correct.
We will sorry, go ahead.
So, and we'll be discussing this under item number 17 in the council agenda.
Right,
as well.
So we'll be adopting
We're moving forward with the recommendations concerning
16,
item number
sorry,
36,
yeah. Yeah.
And then the discussion with respect to the urban center's secondary plan will come forward as report number 2014-31, item number 17 on the council agenda. So we can move this, we can move these recommendations forward and then deal with the secondary plan when we're having this discussion. That was your intent, Regional Councillor, with those minor amendments, okay? And the seconder as well? Okay, and also I want to clarify that we'll deal with this with the exception of the two properties that were declared by Councillor Hempen, so that Councillor Hempen can do that and we'll deal with those two properties as they're affected separately. That's the appropriate way, Mr. Clerk. Okay, Regional Councillor.
Yeah, again, I just want to, because it could be some time later that we're looking at this, but it's I'm concerned that it's reading right now that the plan will include the following language, one and two. And the way it's meant to read is that the plan will include the following language, one, and then I think it's probably better to have B, because it's a separate recommendation about process after the, it's that number two is not meant to be language included in the plan. It's a recommendation on direction, so probably better to take that two out and put B, right?
And B, the proposed.
That's how we met the member of committee of the whole. One was the philosophical direction to the communication.
Yep, we're separating that. And we'll get more detailed discussion on that when
Thank
we get
you.
Into this. Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor? And that's with respect to all of those items with the exception of those two properties that we have a declaration on. So all those in favor? The move the report with respect to the extent that they affect those two properties for which we have a declaration. Yes. Mover, Councillor Emanuel, seconder, Councillor Sponga. All those in favor?
We're still voting on the original. Okay.
Okay. The motion's passed?
The regional councillor's motion has been passed.
Okay.
So you're suggesting that
that we have a separate record of the that deals with the official plan that excludes the properties.
Okay, we'll have to prepare that after the in the minutes.
Okay.
That's easier to do.
It won't be shown on the screen.
Not at this moment. No.
But the record will show that that Councillor Hempen did not vote with respect to those items.
That direction.
Okay.
So I didn't catch that it was a Councillor Emanuel or Councillor Sponga.
That's correct.
For the excluded properties.
That's right.
Maybe just do a verbal vote.
Yep. Could we raise our hands then?
Yeah.
Okay, so we have that. And the record will note that Councillor Hempen did not. Okay, thank you. Now, the next item then is the committee of the whole closed session for June the 16th. Could I have the motion then that the minutes of the committee of the whole session of June 16th be approved, please? Councillor DiMuccio, seconded by Councillor Emanuel. All those in favor? That is carried. Okay. Councillor Kerwin, Councillor Twinney, and Regional Councillor. Thank you. Okay. So with respect to the minutes of June the 16th, the first item was with respect to proposed acquisition of land by the municipality in Ward 7. Could I have a motion, please, that report number 2014-22 be received and that staff be directed to proceed as authorized in the June 16th, 2014 Committee of the Whole closed session? Councillor Emanuel, seconded by Councillor Vague. All those in favor? Was item one of that meeting. Item number two then is also regarding proposed disposition of land by the municipality in Ward 2. So could I have a motion, please, that the Chief Administration Officer and Corporate Services Legal Services closed session report 2014-15 regarding proposed disposition of property be received and that the recommendation in report number 2014-15 be adopted. Councillor Kerwin, Regional Councillor. All those in favor? I think that deals with the minutes of June the 17th, or June the 16th, of the closed session. Okay. Next item, number 13, is the ratification of actions related to matters arising from the Special Committee of the Whole closed session meeting of June 23rd. Sorry, the open session is first? Yes, you're right. Okay, the open session. Thank you.
And that's listed as the minutes under item 23.
And the open session component is item number 23.
Yeah,
yep. Item number 23, the development charges reviews. Who's the mover? Okay. Councillor Emanuel, seconded by Councillor Sponga. Councillor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a question of clarification. That review will be coming up to council in one of our next meetings for adoption. Is that correct? Is that what the direction was today? Okay, thank you.
That's correct. That'll be coming forward. If you take a look at page 100, it's item number 5A. The recommendation is that the report be received and that staff was directed to report back to council on July 21st with the finalized development charges bylaw and the groundwork study for adoption. So that's correct. Any further discussion? All those in favor? That is carried. Bouncing back and forth here. That deals with item number 13 and 23. And then the next item is item number 14, which is the ratification of actions, matters arising out of the closed special committee closed session of June 23rd. Councillor Sponga. Councillor Emanuel. Actually, for ratification, we're actually dealing with each item individually, are we not? That's right, rather than the minutes. Okay. So let's deal with the report number 2014-9 regarding employee negotiations. And the motion that I would ask for, so we'll withdraw the previous motion.
Okay.
With the consent. The motion that I would ask for is that the CAO Human Resources closed session report 2014-9, dated June the 16th, be received, and that the CAO work within the provisions of the approved 2014 budget with respect to the employee negotiations as per the approved policies, including the salary administration policy, HR 9-1, and economic adjustment policy, HR 9-0.03. Can I have a mover and a seconder, please? Councillor Emanuel, Councillor Sponga. All, Councillor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Glad to see a different version of the motion, but I will ask you through you to the CAO, are these policies HR 9.01 and HR 9.03, they are public policies? I'm assuming that's public information, and where could we find that?
Mr. Shelton.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yes, they are public policies.
And where could they? Where could we find those policies? Are they put in on the website? Can I? Do I have to go through staff to get them?
Mr. Shelton.
They are on our internal internet. I'm not sure about the website, but they certainly are available to the public. We can place them on there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. All those in favor? Councillor DiMuccio?
You didn't ask if they were opposed. So.
Opposed. Well, the opposed. It's recorded. That is carried. Next item is the ratification of item number two. Could I have a motion then, please, for the CAO Human Resources closed session report 2014-10, and that it be received and that staff proceed as per the recommendations set out in the report.
So moved.
Councillor Hampen. Seconded. Councillor Kerwin. All those in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. Next item is ratification of item number three, and that is report number 2014-08 regarding personnel matters about an identifiable individual. So could I have a motion, please, that the CAO Human Resources closed session report 2014-8 be received and that staff proceed as per the recommendations set out in the report. Regional Councillor, Councillor Pegg. All those in favor? We'll wait for this to end. Did I forget to say that was carried last time? Is that? Sorry.
Maybe we can just take a verbal vote, perhaps.
Okay, let's do it. Okay, so we're a little technical difficulty here. Mm-hmm. So all those in favor, raise your hands, please. And then opposed? Okay, two opposed. That carries. And I believe that deals with the minutes of the special committee of the whole. Next item is the corporate services report, financial services 2014-28, the consolidated financial statements. Also related to this item is item number 26 and item number 27, which are on the addendum. Item number 26 is an excerpt from the audit committee meeting, and item number 27 is a corporate services financial report related to our financial statements. Could I have a mover with respect to the recommendations that are contained in the report?
So moved.
Councillor Sponga. Councillor DiMuccio, wish to speak to the reports at all, Councillor Sponga? Councillor DiMuccio is the seconder? Okay. This is the approval of our financial statements, and it includes item 26, 27, and item number 15 all together. Does that create a challenge for the clerk's department? Nope. Okay, great. All those in favor? Regional Councillor? Thank you. Okay, item number 16 is report number 2014-45, and it relates to the Oxford Homes Residential Subdivision, Phase 1C, petition with respect to the removal of the sidewalk. We have the recommendations before us. Can I have a motion with respect to the recommendations? Councillor DiMuccio, Councillor Emanuel. Any discussion? Councillor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I sat down with our Director of Engineering, and while we have yet to go to the residents to discuss this issue about a proposed sidewalk that was actually in the blueprint of the development in the subdivision agreement, we will seek staff support in perhaps working a solution, because it is a very wide sidewalk. In the wintertime, getting rid of the snow there, so we can hopefully go in that direction. Thank you.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the recommendations? That carries. Next item, number 17. Do you have any other items of business to deal with? Those are all related, are they not?
The two are related to the...
Yep. Second. So we're also dealing with item number 24 and 25 in the addendum, which relate to item number 17, and that's correspondence that's received. So we have the recommendations before us. Could I have a mover and a seconder for that? Councillor Emanuel, seconder?
Yep.
Regional Councillor. Councillor Emanuel is the mover? Okay. Regional Councillor is the seconder.
We're moving forward here on our secondary plan that we've been working on for a considerable period of time, certainly actively for 2 years. And a great deal of public consultation has gone into this secondary plan. This secondary plan cascades down from provincial policy and to regional policy and down into town of Newmarket policy. We've been given growth targets and both by the province and the region, and this is the necessary kind of planning document that needs to be done to manage this kind of direction, this kind of growth. It would be, in my opinion, it would be irresponsible to not go through a planning process of this nature at this time. So this allows us to move forward with the intent and reflect in our official plan, where the goal was to protect and preserve existing residential neighborhoods and to direct the majority or the bulk of the growth to our centers and our corridors, or in particular our Yonge and Davis corridor, which essentially makes up the bulk of this secondary plan. The secondary plan has gone through, as I said, quite a bit of public consultation, and it's gone through a lot of debate and discussion by this council over this time period. And we've, I believe, come to a plan that is a balanced approach. And this is a balanced approach in terms of taking into consideration many different opinions within the public realm, and also in terms of stakeholder organizations, landowners, other bodies and other levels of government who are inputting into this plan. So I think that it's a very solid blueprint for the future. It's a very responsible way to manage the growth that we've been given and to move us forward. Certainly there's a lot of debate and discussion around the types of buildings we wanted. We've put in place such measures as a design review process to ensure that we have buildings of excellence to ensure that when developers come to the community that we have a very good built form. We've reduced the heights of the buildings and trying to spread the intensification out along the corridors and create a connectivity along the corridor as opposed to pockets or nodes of development. We've also, by decreasing somewhat the heights and the densities, we've hopefully encouraged people to bring forward proposals for buildings that would get built today and not a decade from now. which will go to serve, the seniors who are looking for options to downsize and the added population to our communities. So, there's an awful lot that can be said about this. At the very end of the, at the end of the day, we also added a legal review that will hopefully go some distance in ensuring that this plan holds up to the degree one can hold up at the OMB. But we've given careful consideration to making sure the language is as strongly worded as it can be to protect us in the case where, that we find ourselves at the OMB. And finally, we've added motions and language at the end that will create a binding process following the secondary plan, but before adoption at the region, that will ensure that the growth that we're going to see coming, which is coming to the town of Newmarket about 2% growth per year, which is on the lower end of the growth in the municipalities in the region, but still provides a certain amount of economic activity and housing options. As we see that growth come forward, the work we're going to do in the coming year will start to phase that growth and ensure that certain infrastructure triggers are met as population moves forward, or it will not move forward, or proposals or blocks of development won't move forward. And so we're doing the necessary follow-up work to ensure that the necessary infrastructure, whether that's recreation or schools or sewers or water, various types of infrastructure within the communities in place, in particular roads, road networks, transit. So I think there's been a lot of thought. We've put a lot of provisions in there to protect the community going forward and to manage the growth that's been mandated by the province of Ontario. And I think that while often a difficult process and an emotional process, it's going to be a document that that puts us in good stead and gives us a very solid planning platform to move forward on in the coming decades. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Sponga.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I remember about in 2000, the end of 2011, a resident of Willsted, during a consultation with Kerbal around a development proposal by Young and Millard, looking to our planning staff that was in attendance that night and saying, is there any chance that we could put a road that would go parallel to Young Street behind these developments up Young Street? And that was perhaps the earliest indication that I saw of community engagement in the development of a second plan. It just got better and better from there in terms of the community engagement and how every resident of Newmarket, hopefully, took part in this very, very important discussion. In 2004, this municipality, through a regional provincial legislation and regional designation, we were identified as a urban center within the one of four urban centers within the region. The first plan was to protect our established neighborhoods and concentrate the growth in our corridors. And we have now moved forward with a very cautious plan that sets out how that intensification is going to occur on our corridors, but not just the plan, but it's also attached to it a process that will ensure that the growth can only occur when our pipes, our roads, our parks and schools are ready to take that growth. And I think that's a very responsible approach. So I want to thank members of staff, Miriam Plante, the planning department, commissioner, great work, and members of council. It's been a very long haul. So thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councilor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Certainly, Regional Councillor John Taylor is correct. We certainly had a robust discussion in the last council meeting on this, so I'm going to try to not say as much, and hopefully this time when I do state my opinion that is different from my colleagues, I'm not called irresponsible for doing so. One of the things that I appreciate about our community is that we do have close-knit neighborhoods. When we first came to Newmarket, as many families did, we chose this location because it was a very small community. It had the charm that many families like. And a lot of those families came from the larger densities like Toronto or Vaughan or Markham, just to escape all that. And so that's what attracted me to Newmarket. And again, the regional councillor is correct. This is a legislative process we're going through. Every 5 years, we are required to update our secondary plan. But I think it's also important to understand that in 2005, the province of Ontario did designate Newmarket as an urban growth center in the Places to Grow plan, thereby really limiting us somewhat in terms of our growth. At that time in 2005, in 2008, sorry, it was required that 100,000 people, it was mandated to grow by the province to almost 100,000 people in the next 15 to 20 years. And I believe it was last year when York Region Council asked the municipality to add another 30,000 people to that plan, something that I fundamentally disagree with, and I'll tell you why. Ontario, it's true that York Region is one of the largest populations that is growing in Ontario, but we in Newmarket have one of the smallest. We are one of the smallest sized municipalities, 14 square miles, and right now, currently, if we were to adopt this plan today, the people and I had asked staff for these numbers. The people per square kilometer in 2026 would be over 3,400 people. Today in Mississauga, there's over 2,440 people. So we would even be more higher in density per person per square kilometer than Mississauga is today. And that's a big deal. That to me is something that I don't believe that we have the space for. I think that it's fair to say that when our neighborhoods become, when there's a lot of development, I think that, we're going to see more cars on the road. We're going to see more congestion. We're going to see a lot of other social problems. And I know that York Region Police invests in that because they certainly foresee that in the future. So, again, are we mandated to accept a new plan? Yes, we are, but. And I know my colleagues will agree that I don't have to sit here and say that I agree with it, because we also accepted, I know several members of council were very proactive about a private members bill that came before the province about protecting existing neighborhoods. And I know that we can work with the province in trying to change that. And this is what I'm doing here. By saying no to this plan, which I believe is very aggressive, I'm actually saying that the province needs to do more and the region has to do more, and that I don't accept what is before me. And I don't have to accept what's before me. It's not irresponsible for me to say that I don't accept it. It's very responsible for me to use my voice as an elected member of this council to speak out on legislation that I think is flawed. And the private members bill that was before us, it is true that I did not support that bill, but the reason I did not support the private members bill in preserving existing neighborhoods is because I believe it was fundamentally flawed, and in fact I did speak to certain members and MPPs about this bill. So I'm not going to get into that right now because it's too complex of an argument, but I see the future, and I don't like the growth problems that are going to come with this level of growth, and that's why today I am voting against this recommendation. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Regional Councillor.
Thanks very much. Just want to clarify a couple of things. I don't believe you can find anywhere that York Region Council asking Newmarket to add 30,000 people. So I'm not sure about that. And as well, I just want to point out that we're not mandated to do a secondary plan at this point. In fact, the legislation calls for an update of your official plan every 5 years, and we are legislated to do that, and that will be coming shortly upon this, but they are not the same thing. They're separate processes. The simple fact of the matter is, and over the years and over the elections, you'll hear, people say, I'm going to take a stand on growth, and it's admirable, and I've seen it in many communities and many times, and it reflects certainly a lot of people's frustration in the community with the kind of challenges that growth brings. But at the end of the day, the province has declared us one of the four urban growth centers, one of 27, I think, or 29 in the province. That comes with certain requirements for the urban center itself in terms of people per certain amounts of people within that area. I forgot the exact term at the moment. It requires. The province requires the municipalities, the upper tier, the region, to do growth exercises that then cascade that population target that the province has set. So the province has set population targets of originally for 2031 of 1.5 million people. And they recently amended that to 1.59 million people, which would have about us see about another 7,000 persons in growth in Newmarket, if you put that out evenly, never mind recognizing that we're a designated growth center. Then they've indicated that by 2041, that will go to 1.8 million, roughly, 1.79 million, 1.8 million. And that growth, if cascaded out and not even recognizing that an increased share might be expected of us as a designated growth center with certain targets for the regional center, would put us in the range of close to 140,000 people. And so, you know, I guess what we've done and what I've done throughout the process is to put forward actual motions to try to make the plan protect the community as well as we can. But I think for myself, I couldn't just say on the final minute of the final day, I oppose this, and never having put forward a recommendation to improve it or change it or make it different. We have got to do it. If the secondary plan is going to help us manage growth, then we better manage it. And we better do that on behalf of the people as opposed to let chaos reign. And this is recognizing certain imperatives. My experience has taught me that you can rage against the machine and say, no growth, no growth, no growth, but it's coming. I think everybody can look around and look and saw Richmond Hill grow and Markham grow and Newmarket grow and East Gwillimbury grow. And if you think it's stopping, I've got news for you. So if it's not, then you better do the right thing by the residents and plan for it properly and plan the infrastructure properly and put the plan in place to manage as best we can and protect our communities, our existing residential communities, and plan for a positive and a connected and a healthy corridor along Yonge and Davis. Is this what everybody wants? No, not necessarily. But to stick our heads in the sand wouldn't be the answer either. And so move forward on this knowing that we've done the work that we needed to do on behalf of the residents of Newmarket, looking out for their best interests.
Thank you.
Finally, I'd like to add a motion today to an amendment to the motion that we have in front of us. And I'm open to some staff direction here, but it's with regards to 212 Davis Drive. 212 Davis Drive is the property that is proposed for the rental building in Newmarket. And there's been a pilot project both in cooperation with the town of Newmarket and the region of New York to see this project potentially move forward. There are three private road or lanes that are in our secondary plan on one of our schedules that intersect the property. One, I believe the landowner is accommodated for. Two are still, I think, uncertain as to how or if they can be accommodated. I know staff is still in conversations. But I guess I'd like to know from staff, is there a way to either pass the plan with those held in abeyance at the time being until we resolve it? And if not, first I'd like to know if that can be done in any way.
Okay. Mr. Prentice?
I'd invite the Director of Planning to come down if he'd like to make any comments on it. But I think that staff's position on this is what's put forward in the secondary plan. That being said, staff would work in either scenario, dealing with the applicant with it in the plan between now and the time the region finally approves it, or as a matter that is deferred and to be finally resolved with further comments to the region when it comes to their approval.
Mr. Nethery?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, I certainly concur with the commissioner's comment. I guess to the regional councillor's point in particular, another option might also be to, on the schedule that illustrates the road pattern, we could perhaps defer that information at least until we can resolve the issues that are before us on the site plan.
So if I were to put forward an amendment to defer the fine grid or the road network on 212 Davis Drive until a future date, is that?
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, through you, I think that would work. I think they were characterized as private lanes, so you could use that language in your motion.
And then that would by deferring it sometime between now and going to the region with the plan,
that
you would come back
intent.
To council. Is that correct?
Yeah. There's a solution to be had on this. We just need to have a chat with them, that's all.
Okay, so I'll move that amendment that we defer the private lanes on 212 Davis Drive until a future
Councilor
date.
Minden, do you see that as, I think you moved, you were the seconder on that. Do you see that as a friendly amendment?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Yep, I want to clarify with Mr. Nethery. Isn't there some language there that talks about it being a general design and the final details need to be? And would that not capture it as well, or?
Mr. Mayor, through you, I believe it would. However, you know, the that particular property owner is concerned, and I think justifiably so. I think we can afford this opportunity to work with him and make sure that he's got the comfort level he needs.
Okay, so we'll deal with that as a friendly amendment with the mover and the seconder. Further comments then? Councillor DiMuccio?
Thank you, Mr. Time. Mayor. You know, there were some allegations made that the facts that I presented to the public were not correct through original Council Taylor, and I'm just reading a report, Community Report 2008, from the town's website, Town of Newmarket, that states, quote, in 2005, the province of Ontario designated Newmarket as an urban growth center. This means that Newmarket is mandated to grow to almost 100,000 people within the next 15 to 20 years. Now, we go forward, 2013, and I just pulled this up while he was talking, that the province approved a new amendment from York Region to the growth plan on May 29th, 2013, which extends the population and the employment forecast to 2041 and also allocates more people and jobs for municipalities across Ontario. When the growth plan was passed in 2006, York was expected to hit 1.5 million, and now we have the target of 1.5 million. By 2041, the region is expected to grow to 1.79 million. So my point is this. When the province originally asked us to grow, they did not ask for that number. It was York Region that asked for that number, and I'm reading this here on this is information from York Region. So that's number one. Number two, when we there was an allegation made that perhaps I could contribute more to making motions and you know, perhaps changing some of the plan. Well, there's two things to that. The first part is perhaps the regional councillor doesn't remember that I did sit, in fact, in the workshops, and I did contribute like every other member of council did here. And we also know that there's a history of this council that any motions, the majority of the motions that I have presented in my term of 4 years have not, in fact, been adopted. So at the end of the day, I believe in my philosophy. I believe in how I'm representing the people that elected me, and I do that with a lot of integrity. And I feel very confident in my vote today. I feel very confident in my position, and I'm sure the regional councillor feels confident in his. But at the end of the day, we respect each other's decisions, and we don't personally make comments that that question our character and our integrity. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Mayor.
Regional Councillor, second, third comment.
Thanks. Yeah. The fact is that, in fact, Councillor DiMuccio, you do make comments like that. So please don't pretend it's only a one side. And the fact of the matter is you've confirmed that the region didn't direct the town to grow by 30,000, and you've confirmed for us that you did not put forward any motions to change or improve the plan. So I thank you for clarifying that.
I'm sorry. Thank you. Again, the information is incorrect. Well, just confirmed that the region asked the province to increase the density, and it's right here, and I'd be more than happy.
That's fine. That record is available for anybody who wishes to see it and will allow people to draw their own conclusions. And I'd like to move forward with this report. My own perspective is that what we have before us is a responsible approach. It's a long-range plan, and we know that we review this every 5 years. And things change as we go forward. So the report, as it is being recommended to Council, I think is very responsible and becomes the basis for which we plan our investments in infrastructure. And without a plan, that can't be done. So, and unless the plan conforms with the provincial growth plan and the regional requirements, it's just not going to get approved. So we need to be realistic about that. So I will be supporting the recommendations as amended. Now, I do also want to deal with this again separately so that we can deal with the declarations that Councillor Hempen has made. So now we have a mover and a seconder, correct? And so what I'll do then is call the question with respect to this report 2014-31, save and accept those items that would affect the properties that Councillor Hempen has declared an interest in. So all those in favor.
As it is.
Mm-hmm. As it is. Okay. So this is save and accept the property, right? Okay. Opposed?
Councilor DiMuccio.
Okay, that's carried. Move the recommendations as they apply to the declared properties. Okay. Seconder? Councilor Kerwin?
That's good. Just do that by verbal vote, and I can note, and we'll have to prepare that because we won't have like
okay.
The last
all right.
Motion.
So we'll just deal with that as a as an independent vote. Yeah. Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? Councilor DiMuccio?
It's just being done by.
Okay. Thank you. And that carries. So the next item then is bylaws. Okay. Now we have bylaws number 2014-35-36. We also have under item number 28, 29, and 30, we also have bylaws. And I'd like to deal with bylaw item number 29 separately because it is, and the clerk will give us the numbers of the bylaws, but that item number 29 is the bylaw that deals with the official plan amendment. So we'll deal with items 35, 36, and item number 28 and 30. And those are the ones you're moving, Councillor
yes.
Sponga? And seconded by Councillor Emanuel. Okay. You need to wish to read the bylaws out?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The bylaws are 2014-35, which is a bylaw to authorize the execution of an agreement for the transfer of federal gas tax revenues. 2014-36 is a bylaw to exempt lands from part lot control, Eagle Heights. 2014-38 is the appointment of a provincial offenses officer. And 2014-40 is to adopt Official Plan Amendment 11, Active Transportation Network.
Okay. All those in favor? Is that we're going too fast there? All those in favor? Okay. Electronic versions. Councillor Hempen. Councillor Twain. Okay, great. Thank you. All right. And let's deal with item number 29, which is the bylaw for the Urban Center Secondary Plan. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel. And that is with the exception of the properties that we have a declaration on. All those in favor? Wait. Okay. Opposed? And that is carried. Now we'll deal with that bylaw as well to the extent that it affects those properties for which we have a declaration. Councillor Sponga, Councillor Emanuel. All those in favor? Opposed? None opposed. And that is carried. And the record will show that Councillor Hempen did not participate. Yes. Okay. So the correspondence that was related to that to item number 17, the intent was that it be received as well. That's everybody is okay with that. We'll deal with that as just an administrative notices of motion. Announcements and community events. Councillor Emanuel. Councillor DiMuccio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening. On Sunday, July 20th, Experience Cultures of the World, right in Newmarket at the 5th Annual Around the World Multicultural Event from noon to 8:30 p.m. at the Newmarket Riverwalk Commons, 200 Doug Duncan Drive. This event features international cuisine, cultural music and dance, heritage displays, storytelling, folklore, and more, and admission is free. Thank you.
Councillor Sponga.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Just a quick announcement that on Wednesday evening, June 25th at 7 p.m. at the Community Center Lands, I'll be hosting my last ward meeting of the term. So look forward to seeing the residents of Ward 5 then. I also have something else, Mr. Mayor, if I could.
Sure.
The farmers market this Saturday perhaps enjoyed one of the most successful, if not the most successful, market day of its 15-year life. I just wanted to acknowledge somebody very special. In 1998, Mr. Mayor, I phoned the town of Newmarket, and I didn't know who to call. I actually was asked by a resident if I could head this up and call somebody to find out if it was possible to have a farmer's market. And when I phoned, I don't think we had a customer service department back then. I was put through to Mr. Rob Prentice. I still remember asking him, I remember where I was standing in my backyard, and I said, hello, Mr. Prentice, is there any way we could do a farmer's market in Newmarket? And he said, well, how can I help you make it happen? So, Rob, on behalf of the community, thank you so much for everything you've done. Thanks. Personally.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you. Councillor Hemp.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Starting August 18th, Moonlight Movies are back for another season. You can watch your favorite movies on a huge inflatable screen outside under the stars. Don't forget to bring a lawn chair or a blanket and a donation of a non-perishable food item for the Newmarket Food Pantry. Movies begin at dusk. For a list of dates and locations, please view the community events listing available online at www.newmarket.ca through our Recreation and Culture Department. I also wanted to again mention the today is a very exciting day for Ward 4 and our town, in that we opened up our first community splash pad. That splash pad is behind Canadian Martyrs School, and there's three or four access points, one from Yorkshire, one from Cherrywood, Harrison, and London Road, right behind Canadian Martyrs School. It's a great facility, and the warm weather is here, and residents of Ward 4 and the town are going to have a great place to enjoy. There will also be an official opening, which will take place, I'm going to give you the date here, it is Monday, July 7th at 10 a.m. to 11 p.m. So I hope to see residents there and look forward to them using the new facility.
10 a.m. to?
10 to 11.
Okay. Thank you.
July 7th.
Regional Councillor.
Well, just want to start letting people know, I'm not sure this needs too much announcement, but for anybody new to town, Canada Day is coming up in the town of Newmarket and the Canada Festival, July the 1st. Celebrations are going to start with the traditional pancake breakfast by the Newmarket Car Club. That's 8 a.m. to 12 noon, and that's at the community center. Then there's going to be all kinds of things going on at Ferry Lake all day long from 11 to 4 p.m. And at the Newmarket River Rock Commons, there's going to be a sports village, and that's going to have sports activities and games. And as well there that day, come and meet Gabby Daleman, the Canadian women's figure skater who was in the 2014 Olympics. And of course, at around 10 p.m., the fireworks at George Richardson Park on Bayview Parkway. But come out to one or part of it and be a part of the best Canada Day in Canada.
Thank you. Councillor Twenty.
So this announcement is probably one of my most excited announcements that I've made this term. I'm pleased to announce that we're having a public meeting this coming Thursday, June 26th, from 6:30 to 8:30. And it's going to be in the council chambers here at the municipal offices. And it's regarding providing information and regarding input regarding a proposed leash-free dog park. This is something that we've been working on this term, and I'm really excited to see that it's starting to come together. The proposed location is across from George Richardson Park off of Bayview Parkway. And part of this project is going to be requiring to have 50% of the project funded through private donations or sponsorships. So I would encourage everybody that is looking to have a dog park in Newmarket to come out and attend this evening. It's June 26th from 6:30 to 8:30. Also, if you're not able to come, please have written comments that can be submitted to the public about the public meeting or to our engineering services by June 27th. If you're unable to attend, you can contact Meredith Goodwin at 905-953-5300, extension 2518, or you can email Meredith at mgoodwin@newmarket.ca and provide any details that you would like added to this to this PIC. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Kerwin.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Beginning July the 2nd, join us Sunday at the Riverwalk Commons and Wednesday evenings at Ferry Lake. And this is for your local entertainment, and that is from 7 o'clock until 8:30. And you'll find local entertainers, and it's just a great evening. So once again, one is being held in Ferry Lake itself, where the amphitheater is, and that's on the Wednesday. And then on the Sunday, it's at the Riverwalk Commons, and lots of people there, and you get to watch the kids play in the semi-splash pad. Also, Mr. Mayor, it would be remiss of me if, along with Bob Shelton, having known Rob Prentice the longest here, which is a very long time, Rob, publicly, I'm going to miss your depth of knowledge about the town. You've been a dedicated servant of this town for many, many years. I thank you. You've had a great influence on me, along with Susan Plamondon. I could always go to her, and then I could go to you, and you were a calming measure during my career on council. So publicly, I thank both of you. Susan's no longer here. She's in King. But thank you, Rob. It's been a great journey.
Councilor Vitt.
Thank you. Sometimes I wonder how we survive. What do we do without Riverwalk Commons before? It's the time of year right now where any weekend, visit Riverwalk Commons any weekend during the summer. There's events going on. There's music. There's food. It's absolutely incredible what's happening there. And events Ferry Lake every weekend, too. So Newmarket is the place to be, especially in the summertime. On the weekends, the events that we have there. And then even at Riverwalk Commons now, as Councillor Kerwin already mentioned, we have other events happening throughout the week. So it's such a well-used, such a popular property that we've developed, quite frankly. So, for example, just coming up on June 24th, which is tomorrow, actually, we have the Outdoor Discovery and Adventure Night at Riverwalk Commons. That's going to be for an evening of discovery and interactive fun with Mr. Magic. So I'm assuming Mr. Magic is does incorporate some sort of magic act or show. But please do bring your lawn chair. One of the things we've done at Riverwalk Commons, we didn't put a lot of benches there. We want you moving around, standing around. We want a very portable place there. And if the weather does not support us doing an event outside, certainly the event will be moved inside to Newmarket Community Center and Lions Hall. The admission is free. If you'd like to find out what's happening this summer at Riverwalk Commons and at Ferry Lake and throughout the town, just visit our website, newmarket.ca, or you can give us a call here, 905-895-5193, for more information.
Thank you. The Humber River Shakespeare returns to the Ferry Lake Park to present Romeo and Juliet. There will be three performances at the park at 7 p.m. on July 17th, the 19th, and the 24th. And the emphasis is on making text understandable and accessible, both the Shakespearean novice and the experienced theater patron will understand the program as it goes forward. The production will inspire and captivate audiences of all ages, and performances are pay what you can with a suggested donation of $20. The town offices are closed on July 1st to observe the Canada Day holiday, and a special council meeting to approve the development charges is scheduled to be in these chambers on July the 21st at 1:30 p.m. And the next council meeting will be on Monday, August the 11th at 7 p.m. Covers the announcements. Any new business? Councillor Kerwin.
Just briefly, Mr. Mayor. With regard to our trail system, the Tom Taylor Trail, or the Nokita Trail, which runs all the way from Aurora right through up into East Gwillimbury and projected to go into Georgina. But just a courtesy for those with a bike, if you have a bell on it and you ring it when the pathway is crowded, we would appreciate that.
And to the residents who raised the issue with me, I will be having a meeting with our commissioner, Mr. McDougall, on ways of making that pathway safer for both pedestrians and cyclists. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Mucho.
This is new business, Mr. Mayor.
It is.
I just, you know, we just, I know that council passed a motion that relies on somewhat some fundraising for a dog park, but I wanted to know what the, what we know, and I've asked this before, but is there an update on the fundraising, the donations coming from the public in regards to the town hall?
Mr. McDougall.
Do we have an update on that?
Sorry. On which?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
With the dog park at the town hall?
Well, I was, I mean, I mentioned that, you know, there's yet more fundraising, and I'm just trying to get an update on the old town hall, because okay. We had...
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Through you to Councillor DiMuccio, there is a community group that is activated and is working on the groundwork in terms of the old town hall. There's been nothing substantially raised to date. However, they're really just gathering their forces. They've got a good plan that they're working on, and they're very optimistic in regards to their success. There was one revolving one donation in the amount of approximately $50,000 that went towards the target, which was the target is $550,000, and that went towards a component within the building. But the remainder is still in the planning phases. The group's very active and is planning on coming back to council with a detailed update very soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now. The items that I have not checked off on the addendum is items number 24 and 25, and they relate to item number 17. So I believe that we dealt with that in conjunction with when we dealt with that report. And so we have the confirmatory bylaw.
So move it.
Councillors Bunga, Councillor Kerwin, all those in favor?
Which digit?
No, let's wait till we till the button works. Councillor Bunga. Okay, thank you. Confirmatory bylaw has been dealt with. And motion to adjourn. Councillor Bunga, Councillor Kerwin, all those in favor? That is carried. Thank you very much. It's been a long day. We've accomplished a lot. And we've set the framework for a great community going forward. And I'll vote for that, too.
Okay. Opposed.